Hi everyone, and warmly welcome to the first Avaus Expert Talks online series of 2021. The last few years we at Avaus have been organizing great physical events, sharing experiences from different industries, bringing together thought leaders and practitioners to talk about data, automation, and how to future-proof your organization for what's ahead of us. And this year we're going online because of COVID, as you probably realize. Here's a small sneak peek of the coming topics for the spring. More topics for the fall will be launched soon, but you can already now look at your itinerary and sign up for these at the link at the bottom of the screen. We will also be sharing a lot of resources and links to previous presentations, good materials, and so on throughout this webinar. So keep your eyes on the chat window if you want to have an easy way to click into whatever we're referring to. My name is Emma Storbacka. I'm the CEO of Avaus, and today I'm joined here by my colleague Sandra Berggren. We will be sharing our insights on something we call Sales 4.0, data-driven revenue management. But before it's time to move into that, it's my great pleasure to present to you our first visiting speaker, Henrik Larsson-Broman, who's been a big inspiration for me in the past years. And he's going to share with us 5 super trends that will shape the future of sales and marketing. So without further ado, I will hand over to Henrik, and we will save all of the questions towards the end. If we don't have time to answer your question, which you can post in the chat, then we will make sure to reach out to you over email afterwards. So do be active and take it away, Henrik.
Thank you, Emma. So first of all, thank you, Emma, and all of you at Avaus for inviting me to this webinar. It's an honor to be here, actually, and it's an honor to working together with such a great company as Avaus. So my name is Henrik. I'm a researcher within ProSales, a research company, and Mercury International. And the topic I will highlight today is sales beyond 2020, 5 super trends that will shape the future of B2B sales. So I would like to start this session with a short story. And I would like to go back to 1942, when Dr. Albert Einstein was teaching at the Oxford University. And one day he gave an exam to his senior class of physics students. And when he was walking on the campus with his assistant, the assistant suddenly stopped him and said, "Dr. Einstein, this exam that you just gave to the senior class of physics students, wasn't that exactly the same exam you gave to exactly the same class 1 year ago?" Yeah, Dr. Einstein replied. "It is exactly the same." "But Dr. Einstein, how could you do that?" the assistant said. "Well," Dr. Einstein said, "the answers have changed." So what was true 1942 is also true for today. We live in a world where the questions might be the same, but the answers have changed. In other words, what have got us here will no longer get us there. And if we want to have results, we have to start learning things and doing things we have never done before. And this is actually how trends are born. They arise when new innovations and ideas meet a human need in a new way. In other words, trends are indicators of people's new habits, expectations, and behaviors, meaning that they give us new answers on the same questions. For many years, we at ProSales have studied and analyzed hundreds of business trends over time, trends that are shaping the future of sales and marketing. And some of these trends have been given a powerful boost during the pandemic, while others have stagnated. So, what are these trends that gives us new answers on what to do the coming years? Today, I want to share with you five trends that have accelerated the last year and that are shaping B2B sales beyond 2020. And the trends I want to share with you, I call the rise of the filter economy. Time to make self-service a B2B sales strategy. Get ready for the age of sales automation. The boom of subscription-based business models and the era of sales skills transformation. But let me start the first trend with a short story. In the beginning of 2020, many companies was hard hit by the coronavirus outbreak. One of them was the Chinese cosmetics company Lin Xingwan, who lost nearly 90% of their sales in the beginning of the year. However, in 5 days, they managed to go from store sales to e-commerce with the help of Alibaba. And in addition to that, they redeployed its 100 beauty advisors from those stores to become online sales reps using digital tools such as WeChat to engage customers virtually and drive online sales. So Lin Xingwan not only managed to prevent a crisis here. In fact, they increased sales by 200% compared to the previous year. And how is this possible? Well, this is an example of a company that quickly changed their sales model to fit into the rising filter economy. And what is the filter economy? Well, the filter economy can be described as an economy where the majority of all human-to-human sales interactions in business-to-business take place in different physical spaces using a digital filter between them. And this is nothing new. But the question is, what will it look like in the new normal after this crisis? Well, let me try to answer this question by showing you some interesting data on this. This graph you can see here shows the proportion of inside and outside sales reps in business to business in Europe. And between 2013 and 2019, the proportion of inside sales reps grew from 35 to 42%, while the number of outside sales reps decreased from 65 to 57%. And according to surveys, this trend is expected to continue to grow the coming years. And these salespeople representing inside sales here, they already work in the filter economy as they do business from a distance. But what happens? What happens if we add the time outside sales reps spend on filter conversations? Well, then it gets really interesting, because then we get an overview of how extensive the filter economy is. So look at this chart now. From 2013 to 2019, the filter economy grew from 50 to 70% to reach the highest level ever at 94% this year. And our prediction is that in the new normal after this crisis, will end at around 80%, meaning that 4 out of 5 of all human-to-human sales interactions in business-to-business will be based on filter conversations, even in complex sales. So is this permanent? Yes, it is. Why is it permanent? Well, first of all, most B2B buyers have already changed their expectations on this. According to McKinsey, 70 to 80% of all B2B buyers now say they prefer filter conversations before in-person meetings, citing ease of scheduling and increased productivity as the main reasons. But not only buyers has got used to the new way of interacting. The same study shows that 3 out of 4 B2B decision makers now believe the filter sales model is as effective or more than prior to COVID-19 outbreak. And the interesting thing here is that it only took 5 months, 5 months for the majority of all decision makers to change their expectations on this. So is this good or bad? I don't know, but if we want to stay relevant beyond 2020, we have to adapt our way of selling because customers' new expectations are giving us new answers on how to interact. Another trend that has been given a boost during this year is the trend time to make self-service a B2B sales strategy. In the consumer world, this trend has been going on for a long time. We have committed ourselves to do more and more on our own. Everything from doing research on products to comparing, watching reviews, ordering and installing the products we buy. And this consumer behavior has gradually shifted into B2B and is now strongly influencing our sales strategy beyond 2020. So let me start here by showing you some interesting facts. This graph shows that in 3 years, from 2016 to 2019, the number of B2B buyers who say they prefer self-service has increased with almost 80%, from 35 to 62%. And this is a major shift. And today the customers' expectations are probably even higher, as almost 3 out of 4 decision makers now believe self-service is more important to customers than traditional sales interactions. So that is an increase of 48% before the pandemic. And this is not only about e-commerce platforms. During the pandemic, consumption of do-it-yourself content has accelerated dramatically. So look at these mind-blowing statistics here. Consumption of thought leadership content has gone up with 34%. Reading executive summaries is up by 267%. Blogs, do-it-yourself videos, podcasts, handbooks, online reviews, e-commerce, etc. are all on the rise. We do more and more on our own without consulting with a salesperson. And when we see numbers like this, we have to ask ourselves, what does this mean to us? Do we make it easy for the customer or the buyer to access information on their own through the buying journey? So if you haven't made self-service a B2B sales strategy yet, now might be the time to do that. So a related trend to this that also gives us new answers on what to do and that we have to get ready for is the age of sales automation. And what is sales automation? Well, sales automation refers to the fact that automation of sales just received a powerful boost, increasing the demand for contact-free interactions. So just have a look at this map here, showing the explosion of sales automation tools. Today, we have more than 700 sales tech vendors and products that can help us to get ready for the age of sales automations. And many companies are preparing for this new age. During the pandemic, as many as 67% of all companies have accelerated automation and use of AI. And there are so many opportunities in this trend. So let me give you a few examples. Given that the filter economy is here to stay, what if we could record and analyze all filter conversations via, for example, Zoom in real time, revealing why deals are won and lost? Well, this is what this sales tools does, Chorus. It's like a virtual coach that uses artificial intelligence to break down a 1 hour call into a 5 minute highlight and actionable feedback to the salesperson and its manager. And it gives us answers to questions like, does the salesperson talk too much or too fast? Does the salesperson ask engaging questions? Does the salesperson interrupt the customer? And this can be really helpful in times when we need to understand how to engage customers from a distance. Another tool that can be useful in the filter economy. When you, for example, want to invite your contacts on LinkedIn to a conference or a webinar like this, why not use the tool Duck Soup? Duck Soup automates messages to my selected contacts on LinkedIn, a task that is extremely boring and time-consuming when doing manually. But what if we could also automate the copy of the invitation when you use a sales tool like this? Well, this is what the tool ProSales does. It uses machine learning to generate and optimize copywriting in emails so people open, click, and convert more often. It saves a lot of time, but most important, it produces marketing copy that are far more better than human copywriting. But what if you could also automate email conversations with potential clients that actually responded to our copywriting? Well, this is what the tool Conversica does. It's like a customized virtual sales assistant that automatically contacts, engages, and follows up with leads via email conversations until the lead converts into an opportunity, and then hand it over to the sales rep. And this tool does not only automate the customer interaction, it also creates a personalized customer experience and frees up time for the sales rep to focus on the actual selling. So that was just a few examples of tools that can help us to get ready for the age of sales automation and start doing things differently. And another trend that has received a powerful boost during the pandemic is the boom of subscription-based business models. The current crisis has clearly shown how vulnerable many companies are when the market declines. And one of the reasons for that is that they haven't hooked on this major trend and based their business model on the idea of selling a product or a service as a recurring subscription. So let me start here by showing you some interesting facts. This graph finds that companies using a subscription-based business model outperform the product-based peers by wide margins. From 2012 to 2020, subscription companies have increased their sales by 403%, compared to 130% for companies on Standard & Poor's list, 500 list. And more interesting is that while the companies on S&P 500 list saw sales decrease by 10% in quarter two last year, the subscription companies actually expanded at a rate of 12%. And it's not only software as a service and tech companies that have embraced this business model. Industries after industries are switching from ownership to subscription-based business models. So let me give you a few examples here. Let's say you sell lighting, a boring product like lighting. Why not offer light as a subscription? Well, this is what Philips did when they sold light as a service to Schiphol Airport. And it may sound strange, but why should one buy light bulbs and install lighting fixtures when customers just want light? And today, the customer only buys a subscription and Philips do the rest. Another example, let's say you sell machineries. Here, companies like Caterpillar are investing heavily to put hardware sensors on all of their machines in order to sell services as a subscription. And the company intends to double its subscription-based revenues by 2026. Or if you sell shoes, why not do as the Swiss company On does? In September last year, they launched this running shoe, Cyclone, fully recyclable, made of castor beans. And it will solely be available via a monthly subscription. So if you don't have a subscription model yet, it might be time to consider a change. The corona outbreak will probably be the definitive end of one and done deals. And the last trend that have accelerated this year and that we have to say hello to is an era of sales skills transformation. As a result of these disruptive changes, sales and marketing are facing major challenges when it comes to upgrading their employees in skills needed now and beyond 2020. But until now, not much has happened, as spending per employee in training has stagnated since 2010 and is now at an average of about $1,200 per employee and year. But this is about to change. The coming years, we will see a trend break where more companies will invest heavily in upskilling and reskilling their workforce. And why do we believe this? Well, there are many signs of this shift. First of all, in 2019, just before the pandemic crisis, many major organizations started launching ambitious upskilling and reskilling efforts to prepare for the future. In March, the multinational investment bank JP Morgan unveiled a five-year, $350 million commitment to curbing the global skill gap and preparing today's worker for higher technical skills. 4 months later, the e-commerce giant Amazon pledged to spend $700 million to retrain 100,000 employees in order to adapt to an economy increasingly disrupted by automation and new technology. And shortly after that, in October last year, PricewaterhouseCoopers announced it is investing a whopping $3 billion to upskill all of its 257,000 workers. And the decision is made since there have been apparent that there is a huge mismatch between the skills people have today and those needed for the digital world. And this is probably just the beginning of an era of sales skills transformation, especially if you take into account that nearly 9 in 10 executives say their organizations face or expect skill gaps within the next 5 years. And the pandemic crisis has made the need to address this skill gap even more urgent. So what does this mean for all of us in B2B sales and marketing? Well, the last decades, we have seen a long-term trend where traditional sales skills are being disrupted and replaced by new skills adapted to new buying behaviors. In practice, this means that we for a long time have moved in two different directions where sales either become more transactional or automated, which places higher demands on technical skills. On the other hand, we have moved into a direction where sales become more complex and value-based, meaning that we need consultative advisors who possess higher cognitive skills, such as problem solving, analytical thinking, and conceptual understanding. So for many organizations, this means that they are facing a great skill gap that has to be addressed in the new era of skills transformation. So to summarize what I have said right now, many trends are shaping B2B sales beyond 2020. And today I have shared 5 of these trends. All of them have been given a powerful boost during the pandemic. But to be clear here, it's not because of COVID-19, but because of customers rapidly changing habits, expectations, and behaviors. So I'm pretty sure that Dr. Albert Einstein was right in 1942 when he said that the questions might be the same, but the answers have changed. In other words, what have got us here will no longer get us there. And if you want to have results, we have to start learning things and doing things we have never done before. So with that words, thank you very much for listening. If you found it interesting, if you want to get more facts and inspirations about business trends, you are welcome to order our book of super trends, and you can find it in stores like Adlibris, Bookus, and Amazon. And in this book, we highlight 50 super trends shaping the future of sales and marketing. And you're also welcome to add me as your friend on LinkedIn. So thank you very much, and over to Emma and Sandra.
Fantastic. A small virtual applause, Henrik, to you.
Thank you very much.
A great presentation. Right. Let's see here. I almost had some technical problems, but I plugged in my charger, so things should be working out smoothly. Could you, Sandra, let me know that you see my screen, which should indicate that everybody else does as well? Thumbs up. Perfect. So after having heard from Henrik about these exciting but also slightly scary trends, we are going to today, together with Sandra, dive into a few of the topics and the ones that are, of course, most close to our hearts at Avaus. So we're going to talk about how you turn data into business results, how you leverage data and automation to improve sales efficiency across channels and in this new world that Henrik just mentioned. So I'm going to start out with talking a little bit about why data and automation will be so crucial. And we're targeting sort of the year 2025, pertaining to the Gartner study with the same 2025 sales outlook. And I'll tell you a bit more about some findings from there shortly. But then we're going to go into pretty pragmatic winner behavior. So we're going to share with you a lot of tips and resources of how you can start addressing all of these trends and developments that you just heard about. Suvi will be kindly sharing links in the chat. So if you see something you're interested in, you can just click in there right at that point. But everything will also be shared afterwards. So then let's get started. All of you should be aware that we at Avaus have a monthly complimentary Gartner report. And of course, now since we're talking about B2B sales and B2B sales trends, the January report, which is available on our website, is the future of sales in 2025, a trend insights report from Gartner. And we've partnered with Gartner because we feel that research and sort of an objective opinion on what is happening at the moment is so crucial because the development is happening so incredibly fast. So if you haven't read this yet, I would very much recommend you to do so. It's an eye opener. And if you want to dive deeper into what Henrik just said, all of those things are mentioned there as well. It will be available only until the 2nd of February, and then we will change to another report, which will be on data in marketing. So if you haven't yet, please do download that free of charge, of course. So what does it say? Well, one of the most shocking findings in this, I think, is that 33% of buyers desire a seller-free sales experience. And that, of course, is just what Henrik talked about in his lecture just now. Now, that's a pretty disturbing figure if you're running a team of salespeople. How do you deliver a seller-free sales experience that matches the customer's expectations? Gartner also says that by 2025, 80% of interactions between a supplier and a buyer will be in digital channels, just like we just heard. Nothing new there. But one insight that I find especially interesting, and which is a big mindset shift for any sales organization, is that according to Gartner, by 2025, 50% of organizations and chief sales officers will have redefined their roles of leading sales to being leaders of selling. So talking about the whole process of selling not only in the physical channels, but all channels. And that also then means that B2B organizations sort of need to take a jump towards a more data-based and insight-based selling methodology. And why is that then? Well, since we realize that the multi-experience selling is the new reality, you will meet your customers in a multitude of different channels because of the preference from the sellers and the buyers. We'll have more self-service and we'll have more channels available. And that sort of means that the complexity grows. We'll have more touch points. We'll need to follow behavior across different touch points and know what those different interactions meant and indicated. It also means that the personal relationship that we create, the bond that we create to our customers, will be of less importance. It's not saying that it won't be important, but it will be of less importance. So what will then be of big importance to be able to manage in this multi-experience environment? Well, data and automation is the only way you can actually make sure that you meet customer expectations for relevance and consistency. It's the only way to make sure that you can actually proactively serve customers, for example, by predicting when they will be needing your help or service or what they might be needing next. And also, it's the only way that you can interact with your customers across multitudes of channels without increasing your sales costs. So having these three things in mind, the question is, what sort of journey will this be for sales organizations? And we've decided to coin a term we call sales 4.0 because we think it is a clear shift from the perhaps more traditional product focused and then customer oriented sales organizations that now in the past few years might have been, you know, targeting to become digitally enabled, adding new platforms like e-commerce and self-service apps and platforms or marketing automation or all kinds of social selling digital channels. It's actually a pretty big leap to go not only from adding more channels, but to be driving your sales through those channels. And Gartner quotes, the three things really will change: hyper automation, decisions of what to sell, who to sell to, and how to sell based on AI, not intuition. And then that sales experience happening across different channels, the multi-experience sales environment. Now, many of you and many of the clients we work with react to this picture and say, well, you know, we are just getting started from 1.0 to 2.0. We just, you know, rolled out our new CRM or we're doing trainings on solution selling and we're considering adding digital channels. So we want to take it slow and it's step by step. Now, I would like to challenge that and challenge that really, really hard. And why is that? Why do you need to start your journey to sales 4.0 already today, no matter where you are in this sort of maturity journey? Well, one reason for that is that the gap between leaders and laggards is growing at the same pace as technology is evolving. All of the tools that Henrik just showed you, capturing data from a video call, automatically keeping in contact with your clients over email, those features came in the last few years. And 4 years ago, I gave a presentation on AI in sales, and those were sort of the early days. Now it's basic tools that kind of leader organizations are already using. And unless you jump on this exponential value generation curve, there's a really big risk that you will never catch up and that you will never be able to upskill your team to understand how to drive value from data and automation. So there are ways that you can jump ahead and you don't have to take all of the steps one by one. And if you do so, here are a few tips. and maybe to scare you off from your current path, if that is the case, I'm just going to show you a few things that we see quite often happening if you are on the lower development curve. And the first thing is that becoming data-driven typically is no one's job. And that leads to, of course, nothing really happening. So if you're listening here in and thinking that this should be that guy over in IT, or this really should be our sales leadership or CEO or whoever, it's really your job, because all of our competence will need to change. So sort of start with yourself. Another typical problem we see is that there is a kind of perception of needing to have perfect understanding of the world before you know where to start. And typically that leads to a sort of discovery project of some sort, a target stage project. But quite often those don't start from a use case based perspective. And it's more about the technology and inspiration and not about the business target. And we'll get to that soon. So make sure that if you're going into a discovery project, make sure it actually creates tangible plans to go ahead. The third thing we see happening if you're on the lower development curve is that you sort of approach it from a technology perspective. And quite often that ends you up with a Ferrari in the garage and very few data-driven processes. And then you might have the situation that there are no articulated business targets. And we'll get to some solutions for that, but I would just want to share my experience with how seldom I see a presentation of, you know, this is why we want to invest in data, or this is why we want to invest in automation and technologies, translated all the way into sales targets and improvements in sales efficiency. And that's a really good place to start, because then all of the other things will follow in the right order. So how then to be a winner? What are the winning behaviors? And here I'm going to hand over to Sandra to take you through some of them, and I will take a few. So Sandra, go ahead.
Thank you, Emma. So yes, the drilling question of in this new sort of environment that we are living in, how does one become a winner? And what we have done here at Avaus is that we have defined four winning behaviors that we see will help you on the sort of winning path. And the first one is to improve your data literacy. So understanding what data you have and what you can do with it to increase your business results and support the growth path. The second one is, of course, that it's crucial that you have a business vision and clear targets that you're working with. The third thing is that how do we now organize when we know that we need to live in a multi-experience environment? And the thing is now, and there's a shift, we need to organize now for selling and not for sellers. And that's very important from a sales lead perspective. And then lastly, the fourth behavior is that developing your capabilities slice by slice. Don't try to do it all big at once. You will fail in doing so. And going forward now, we will take you through each of these behaviors. And starting with data literacy, if not but one of the most important things that you need to start doing in becoming a winner. And how do you do that? That is a sort of burning question. But first, I mean, we at Avaus, we also need to all the time work at our data literacy. And of course, this is an outcome or a consequence of the fast technological development. But there are some misconceptions that we hear and that we see when it comes to improving your data literacy. And just on the right-hand side here, you see a few examples that we hear. But maybe those that stand out in B2B is that it's very difficult, it's quite scary, and we don't have the data relevant to use in sales. And given these facts, I'm gonna now show you that it's not that difficult and it's not that scary, and you can do it quite quickly as well. So if we look how you can do this, starting with sort of, this is your 1 minute data literacy improvement. At Avaus, we have this sort of framework which is we call data algo action. So fueling your business with utilizing your data. And these are just a few examples on the left-hand side that we see are typical that most B2B companies have. And then also we want to sort of fuel that to support our business. And there are different objectives that you do that with. For example, when do we know, or how can we know when someone wants to buy, or can we do recommendations so we can serve our customers better? But then we need to actualize this in our channels with certain actions that we want to automate. And it can be utilizing your inside sales if you have it, marketing automation, or sending automated tasks directly into your CRM. And this is, so how does this work now? To give you an example, let's say that you want to understand a specific segment that you have already, and you want to understand when would be the most likely next time that they want to purchase from you. Then what we would do is that we would look at third-party data, your web interactions data, that the behavioral data, but also utilize your ERP data. And then we would create an algorithm, which would be propensity to buy for this example. And then we will sort of automate actions, both to your inside sales for those who are most likely to buy, but then for those who might not be exactly ready yet, we want to nurture them with a marketing automation system. And then ultimately we can send direct tasks into the CRM to the account manager, who can take actions based on the insights and the things that the customer has done in the digital channels. I mean, there's a lot to talk about when it comes to data. I'm not going to dive into it now on a super detailed level, but if you want to educate yourself a little bit more on that topic, we have these different materials from our expert talk in Helsinki. And also Emma had a talk about this topic, which you can find in our YouTube channel as well. So this is the first tip. The second tip is that if you want to get inspiration of, okay, so based on our where we want to go, what kind of use cases will support that business that we want to achieve going forward? So we have this cookbook where you have different use cases serving different purposes where you can easily apply this data algo action. And lastly, if you want to educate yourself and increase your own capabilities, we are also now launching this, what we call Avaus Algo Leap training. And it's now opening for signups. We will launch it we will carry them out in August. And we have different levels depending on what kind of role you have. So we have the executive level, the practitioner, and then also if you're in a specific analyst role. So you can go and look into the link and sign up if you're interested.
Thank you, Sandra. So if the first step really is to make sure your own data literacy is in shape, you know how to lead the people around you, or you know how to combine your business targets with what actually can be done, or what actual data you have available. The next step is really to take your team and make sure you have a vision to go against. And one of the things we quite often see is that there is a vision, but it's not concrete enough and it's not scalable enough. So you might have run into a situation, for example, where you pilot, let's say, marketing automation or an e-commerce platform or something else, but only for a very small segment. You never sort of paint the vision of how will this work at scale. And data and automation only delivers at scale. That's when you get the exponential value. So what might a vision look like? If you start looking at a data-driven operation, let's say like Amazon or like Alibaba, which I think would be a brilliant benchmark for most of the companies listening in today, what you would have underneath the hood, underneath the channels, underneath all the sales interactions, is something that probably looks a little bit like this. So we've visualized sort of the full set of a data algo and action setup that might be the engine powering your revenue operations. So on the left-hand side, you see all of the different data sources that you might have. CRM, your e-commerce, all of your ERP data, but also maybe even things like voice from your online meetings with customers or recorded phone calls. And on the right-hand side, you recognize all of the different action channels that you might want to use for triggering actions in sales. That's where the automation piece happens. And in the middle then, you would have the real beauty of it. So the algorithms, the intelligence that decides what data to use and what action to trigger in what channel, be they sort of digital channels or a physical meeting, giving real-time prompts, for example, like Henrik just showed you in the chorus example. So of course, every company will not have such an advanced version of the Nexus, but it's a really good way to start looking at what should our future look like. And I think a really good question to ask your team or yourself is, which are the 100 first automated processes you will create? Because if you start from the fact that you will need to scale up, you will do much better decisions as you go along. And you will also force yourself to capture data in a great way and also organize yourself for scalability, not for individual data algo action use cases, because they won't be able to take you to scale. So which are the 100 first automated use cases then? A good way to start that journey is to look at your business priorities. So do you have a top of funnel problem at the moment? Do you want to drive a cross-sell strategy? Is it more about increasing conversions in your pipeline? Is it about increasing the self-service level? Or is it simply about preventing churn and keeping the customer lifetime value high? Whatever it is, underneath each of these, you will quite likely find between 5 and 25 automated processes that you want to have in place. And a really good step is just to start by doing a business case on where your business opportunity for improvement is the biggest. Now, I won't go into examples here because we did that already last fall. And if you want to download examples of data algo action use cases that you could create together with some pretty inspiring case references, you can do that here on this link. And the main thing to keep in mind is really the scalability of it. So not being too narrow in your planning. Another shameless plug that I'm going to bring here is the fact that we're launching a multi-client study, because we realized that many companies want to start addressing this situation, but don't really know how, and also aren't maybe ready to take the leap and start acting, but would need to improve the data literacy, need to know what your sort of 100 use cases or 25 use cases might look like, as well as assessing, you know, what will we need in terms of capabilities, skills, technical aspects, as well as the actual data and algorithms that you might want to develop in the future or buy as a precepts tool. That's also a critical question to assess. So if you're interested in participating together with around 6 to 8 other B2B organizations, this is going to be a very low cost sort of structured project where you also get to benchmark and learn from the other participants. So I'm really looking forward to that. You can find more on the link over here. So the third area, organizing for selling and not sellers. Sandra, take it away.
Yes. So how should you now, as a sales organization and sales lead, build your capabilities, and how should you be organized to sort of serve the everywhere customer today? And we already know that the change in customer behavior is significant and has huge implications on how to sell. And as sales leader today, you have to shift from being a leader of sellers to a leader of selling, being able to serve in all these channels and respectively in these channels as well. Otherwise, you won't be able to meet the new expectations and the new behaviors that that will be a must for a winner going forward. And also a last point in that is that remember that 33% of all buyers, they don't want to meet you face to face. So if you don't make this change and build that culture and leadership going forward, most likely you will become a laggard and you will be behind and not be a competitor as strongly as you would be in the future. And maybe, so where to start? That's a typical questions that we get. And most companies and customers, they start in the wrong end. They start with looking at technologies. They started looking at how should we organize. Our recommendation is turn the coin around. Start with understanding what data you have and how you can use it, how it will support your business. And then based on that, you will define the use cases. Because when you do that exercise, most likely you will find answers to those things that you see on the right-hand side that you didn't know from before. And then it will be clear who could possibly be in charge of the data topic. And it will force you to break the silos that the majority of the companies that we work with today that we see. And it will, you need to have that joint agenda. And then of course, when you're doing these things, automatically you will learn new things about your customers that then will help you grow your business at the end of the day.
And then finally, to the point which quite often is the starting point for many, and that is the technical piece. And I would really urge you to be very wary of questions like, what data don't we have today? Or what should our platforms in the target state look like? And another favorite is of mine is this, I want to see the customer 360. Those are all great sort of questions to solve, but they quite likely are taking you in a direction of a big IT project with an ROI that starts only a few years down the road. Now, what I would as a sales leader embrace are questions or sort of statements such as, you know, we will start by focusing on upselling because that's most beneficial for us right now. Or we have a lot of data that we could utilize or cross-selling, so that's where we're going to start. Another thing is being really, really concrete on the sort of 50 or 100 or 150 use cases, so that you already from the start make sound decisions on your timeline and your technology decisions. Quite often we let sort of the wrong things steer us in the beginning of our data-driven journey. And these are some examples of you know, what that might look like. Because I think as sales leaders, it's important that you set the tone for how will development towards data-driven and automated selling actually look like. And we talk about slice-by-slice capability development. Now, there are lots of fantastic platforms out there, and we are kind of actively working with and implementing many of them. But what we would really kind of urge you to think about is how can you build your capabilities slice by slice and use case by use case? Because quite often you have all of the data that you need and you would be with very small sort of technical developments able to automate some piece of your sales cycle, be it in digital or non-digital channels. And any company that starts with sort of building this pyramid before actually leveraging it to develop data-driven use cases is very likely to go on this very slow development path. Cloud technologies today also are really great at enabling you to do this. So you can even get started with your data and algo piece by sort of swiping your credit card in a Google Cloud or AWS or Azure environment. So if your notion of sort of an IT initiative starts with kind of massive RFPs and deciding on how this will work, I would strongly recommend you to maybe take a use case based approach first and see, you know, how many of those could you actually already do today with very minimal IT investments or kind of upfront. Then when you want to scale and you want to go global and you want to go across all of your product lines and markets, that's where you probably want to do something more formal. But don't wait with the learning while you sort of get started. So to recap, the four behaviors that we would like to recommend in order to sort of future-proof your B2B sales and marketing organization is, again, to start with the two most important ones. Make sure you yourself understand what data is and what automation will be able to bring to you. And then make sure that your organization has a business vision and clear, measurable business targets. And then you can start working on, you know, how do you organize yourself? Who should own this? What platforms should we have and where to start? And one and two are things that I think you should all have the answer to already this year if you want to make sure that you are amongst the winners in 2025. So I will leave you with this question. What does your target state for your revenue organization look like? What are the 100 first data algo action processes that you will create for yourself? And if you want to discuss this in more detail, we're super happy to be of service. You can connect with us and with Henrik on LinkedIn. And you also have received a lot of sort of free resources today that will help you on this journey. So don't be strangers. Reach out if you have any comments or any feedback. And I hope to see you all in the next Avaus Expert Talks on the topic of what is data in February.